This is the Confucius Museum, or a temple and museum of inscribed stone tablets, I think is the translation. Just off Renmin Road. I went into a small gallery across the street and north a block, Suzhou Modern Ceramic Art Gallery. I don't know what's going on between 1:30 and 3. Suzhou Museum of Inscribed Stone Tablets, yeah. And the Administrative Bureau of Confucian for Suzhou. 9 to 11 and 1, 2, 3. Is that the museum? Is that Confucius there? They have a little QR code if you want to bother. But it's probably going to be a Chinese description. So unless you have a Mandarin, command of Mandarin. Hello. Kitty, 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 kitty. Kitty, 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 kitty. Kitty. Friendly kitty? No, not friendly. Temple kitties. Temple kitty? Some food. A big drum here. I wonder if I can get one of these brochures somehow. Let's see what it says in the Lonely Planet. Oh, here he goes. Time to feed the kitties. Meow, meow, meow. The main hall is being restored. Some intriguing historical stelae are on view. We're here, number 2. Let's see what they say in the DK. The original Song Dynasty temple was rebuilt in 1864 after destroyed by the Taiping Rebellion. That's a familiar story in China, especially in this area. Its main hall, dating from the Ming Dynasty, has several stone carvings, including China's oldest surviving city map depicting Suzhou, or Pingjiang as it was known, in 1229. Also on display is a star chart dating from 1247 that maps the position of stars and celestial bodies in the heavens. One of the earliest surviving maps of its kind. There's the gateway. So I'm up here. Display on Confucian culture at Dacheng Hall. Display on calligraphy tablets of different dynasties. Bronze statue of Confucius, ancient ginkgo trees. Kitty, kitty, kitty. I'm not going to get any attention. So there's a historical stele. They have Wi-Fi? I'm impressed. Nice pagoda gate here. You know, when I went to the Six Harmonies Pagoda yesterday, I walked around their miniature Pagoda Park, and thought they were saying that these styles of gates, which go back to the Yuan dynasty, which would be 1229, can be considered a form of pagoda. Gate style pagoda, do they call it? So if you don't know anything about Confucianism, Confucius lived around, I think, 8500. And he codified social behavior, essentially. And he's much revered in China because of his bent towards paternalism, respect for your parents and authority. And he's got a big influence with students who come to pray for good scores on their examinations. So like it's said in The Lonely Planet, the main hall's being renovated and it looks like it won't be good look like inside. You can watch my video. I went to the Confucian Temple in Shanghai that had been a headquarters for the Little Sword Society, which is what really probably saved it from destruction during the Cultural Revolution. The Little Sword Society was an offshoot branch of the Taiping Rebellion. And if you don't know anything about the Taiping Rebellion, it happened in the 1850s. And a guy by the name, what was it, Hu Chang? He said, oh, my name sounds like flood, so I'm Noah, or I'm Christ, and I'm going to start a Christian cult uprising to overthrow the Qing. So he's actually revered in the Republic, People's Republic of China, because of that, because they're anti-imperialist, and he thought the foreigners would support him, since they had gone to war with the Qing around this time in history, the Opium Wars. But there was a lot of collusion after the treaties were signed, keeping, you know, Qing government had a lot of problems there towards the end, and they were propped up somewhat by their capitulation to the West and the treaties that were signed. And eventually, you know, massive turmoil is not good for business. And so Qing forces combined with some reinforcements from the colonial powers defeated the Taiping Rebellion, but not before an extreme loss of life. I've seen it written that, I think this will support me, I've seen it written that the Taiping Rebellion was the biggest loss of life in human history, the bloodiest conflict in human history. We're talking millions dead. In fact, in Shanghai, the famous style of building there, the stone gate architecture, or Shikumen housing, started because of the Taiping Rebellion indirectly. A lot of Chinese middle and upper class people who were threatened by the peasant uprising of the Taiping Rebellion. That's another reason it's Taiping Rebellion is sort of deified or canonized in the People's Republic, because it was a peasant uprising, like the 1911 revolution, that finally succeeded in overthrowing the Qing. A lot of those middle upper class people, landholding farmers too, fled to Shanghai, and the French and the British, recognizing a good thing, reversed their laws on foreigners living in their concessions. If you don't know anything about the concessions were a area of entrepot, essentially, where the British were allowed and the French were allowed and the Americans, we combined into an international settlement with the British, our settlement, to have their own little fiefdoms independent from Chinese regulations, essentially functioning like a embassy might function today, as little bastions of their own dominion country. And so construction began on massive suburban housing. The Shikumen is a style of housing. Watch my videos from the Shikumen Open House Museum in Shanghai. It's a style of housing that got real popular. It's a mix of traditional style Qing communal housing with, I don't know, say English Row or townhouses. And they call them Shikumen stone gate houses because of the stone gates that were in front with a Baroque pineal, Baroque ornament over the door. So back to Confucianism. Confucianism, like most religions in China, was severely hampered by the socialist communist policy of no religion, and especially during the Cultural Revolution when the Gang of Four tried to implement I think it's similar to what you would find in getting out of here. Shia law or something, like radical fundamentalist religious law, where they try to impose real harsh restrictions on culture. And most temples, when you go around Shanghai, there's hardly any temples. Compare China and Japan, where there's my little neighborhood in Japan that I lived in Tokyo. I mean, every time I walked to the metro, I found a new shrine, a Shinto shrine or Buddhist temple. And in Japan, there's very few that has survived. And even the ones that have survived, like this Confucian temple, may date from an early period, but they've been rebuilt a dozen times. Especially, you always see it written, like it said, the Taiping Rebellion, it was destroyed and rebuilt. And then you see that in Japan, because, you know, we leveled Tokyo, not with a nuclear bomb, but with B-29s. Super fortresses from Saipan. Operation Cartwheel, very successful. Anyway. Ah, you fucker. Sorry. Little bastard. I wear long sleeves and it makes me sweat like a pig, but I'd rather not get eaten up by mosquitoes. So the only vulnerable parts are my face and hands. And if I pop my collar like I'm doing now, they can't get the back of my neck like they just did. So then I can pretty much see or hear them coming. So these look like Confucian temples maybe around the country. I forget the breakdown. It's in my guidebook, actually, of how much Confucianism, how much of the population considers himself Confucian, but there's a real flexible attitude towards religion in East Asia, and people will pray between different temples for their own specific wants, like a good score on a test. Oh, it's a map of Suzhou. Four Song Dynasty stelas displayed in this room refer in particular to the astronomical chart, geographical map. successive dynasties, emperors, chart, and Ping Jiang map. Ping Jiang, like we said, was the name for Suzhou. Preserved in Suzhou Stele Engraving Museum, Suzhou Confucian Temple. Up to now, they are called the four Song Dynasty steles, such as Heaven, Earth, Human Being, and City steles for short. Four steles all carved in Southern Song Dynasty, which was from 1127 to 1279. So I guess that 1229 date would fall into the end of the Southern Song. It would go on for another 50 years past that. 1961, they're made public by the State Council, first batch of historical cultural sites under protection. The author of the astronomical chart, successive dynasties, emperor chart, and geographic map steles among four Song dynasties steles was Huang Shang, a person of the Southern Song Dynasty. Ping Jiang map stele was completed under the management of Li Shupeng, prefect of Suzhou in the Southern Song Dynasty. The former three steles were depicted by Huang Shang in the first year of Emperor Shaoxi's reign, Southern Song Dynasty 1190. Seventh year of Emperor Chun Yu's reign, 1247. Steles were inscribed by Wang Jiwen. Maps are presented by Huang Shang for Di Yishan, attendant lecturer of King Jia, or Emperor. He became Emperor Ning Zhong. Later, Wang Jiyuan got them from Sichuan and brought them back to Suzhou for inscribing. Ping Jiang map stele was carved by Lu Ting, Dijang, Yu Chang, and Dijang Yundi, Yandai. In the second year of Emperor Shao Ding's reign of the Southern Dynasty, Southern Song Dynasty, 1229. So there's the date, 1229. Four Song Dynasty steles were stored originally in Suzhou Confucian Temple. Among them, Ping Jiang map stele was carved deeper by Huang Wai Xuan, a famous stele carving artisan in 1917, and then began to become disappearance. Later, it was once restored in Suzhou Museum, or they had placed it, I guess, in Suzhou Museum. When Suzhou Stele Engraving Museum was set up in the Confucian Temple in 1983, it was retransported back. Four Song Dynasty steles are masterpieces in our country's science and technological history and world science and technological history. Among them, astronomical chart steles, one of the most ancient carved storehouses of astronomical charts in the world. It occupies an extremely important position in astronomical history. Geographic map stele was China's political and geographic map of the Song Dynasty. It now is one of the most ancient carved stone maps in our country. It has very high value in geographic history. Successive dynasties emperor chart stele is now the only carved stone imperial pedigree chart of our country's ancient times. It was an important historical information for studying China's ancient political history. Ping Jiang map stele is a Suzhou city plan figure of the Song Dynasty. It is the most ancient carved stone city plan in the world nowadays. It's also a rare historical data in kind for studying Suzhou municipal construction of ancient times. You can see their constellations are very different than ours. Different zodiac. In some of my videos, I may come across as critical of China, but I actually would revere their culture very much. Stele recording Suzhou's industrial history during the Qing. They have running from 1368 to 1911. That's from the Ming to the Qing. Qing doesn't start till 1644. Written to Suzhou that it was a major metropolitan center of southeastern China. Many merchants gather here and the streets are piled high with produce trading vessels coming here from far off imperial capitals in the north. We're on the Grand Canal that ran from here, from Beijing, across five major rivers of China, south of the Yangtze River, hits Suzhou, and then goes on to terminate later in where I just came from yesterday, Hangzhou, on the Chaitong River. I had a nice view of that yesterday from up on the Six Harmonies Pagoda looking down on the river. Maybe I'll go back in August to see the tidal bore, August 18th. I thought I might stay in Scotland or London, Edinburgh or London for the summer, but I think I'll only be there until about mid-August anyway. Kitty, pss, 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 meow. Lazy kitties. Let's see, trading vessels come here from far off imperial capital in the north, that's Beijing, while others travel to the far south and onto foreign lands. This area of commerce and prosperity is reflected in the collection of over 250 steles relating to industrial, commercial, and economic matters held by the Suzhou Stele Museum. These steles involve 18 major industries and trades including silk, cotton, imported cloth, papermaking, building, woodworking, paints, metalware, gold, silver, jewelry, banking, money, lending, grain, delicacy from north to south China, soy sauce, vegetables and cakes, firewood, charcoal, coal, candles, fisheries, tobacco, service trades, and transport. The quantity and variety of commercial activity made Suzhou one of the leading economic centers of China at the time. Suzhou's commerce-related stele from the Qing dynasty were mostly erected when merchants and workshop owners were establishing a guild hall or local guild in Suzhou. You can watch my video from the guild hall in the Luan district area of Shanghai. Talks a little bit about the guild merchant organizations that started in the late Qing. The one that they have the museum at in Shanghai was the site of a revolt, a workers' revolt, actually, I think in the 20s, perhaps? I don't know. 1920, 25, somewhere in there, maybe. And it was a shipping, because it's on the Huangpo River. I think it was a shipping guild. Some steles were also erected by local officials. Merchant guilds emerged in Suzhou as early as the middle period of the reign of Emperor Wanli of the Ming Dynasty. By the reign of the Qing Emperor, Qianlong guilds were flourishing and they remained active up to the founding of the Republic of China. Some of the most famous guilds were Zhejiang Merchant Guild, Shanxi Merchant Guild, Jiangxi Merchant Guild, Jiaying Merchant Guild, Anhui Merchant Guild, and Shanxi Merchant Guild, Tea Merchants Guild, Southern Zhejiang Guild, and Jiangsu Shandong Guild, Jiayi Guild, Chaiyang Guild, and Pharmacist Guild. Zhejiang's the province I just came from where Suzhou is, and the others, Anhui, is a province bordering Jiangsu. Yeah, there's a nearby. Besides recording the development of various industries in Suzhou, these stele also reflect the growth of capitalism with the mercantile economy.
particularly interest in reflecting social currents of the time are several famous steles, including Suzhou Prefectural Edict Against Labor or Unrest, 1701, and Permanent Prohibition of Workers' Strike, 1734. The numerous Suzhou steles dealing with industrial and commercial matters in the Qing dynasty provide resources for studying the history of proto-capitalism in China. It's a mouthful, huh? Capitalism. The West is decadent and divided. Well, everybody in China cares about making money right now, I think. At least the policymakers. Economic growth here has been impressive, but it comes at a price. You know, you develop too fast, you can have a bubble, you can have economy that's propped up, of course, famously by the artificially low pegged currency. I don't know how they get away with that. They joined the World Trade Organization under Bill Clinton, of all people. I hear ABBA. You cannot have in the time of your life. Dancing Queen. Lotus. They're starting to bloom, huh? It's another reason I'd like to go back to Hangzhou in August. I hate it when music's playing in the background like that. If YouTube picks it up, then I can't monetize this video. And I have no control because it's running in the background. It's like incredibly difficult to mute it and still have my voice playing. And it's wafting over from somewhere over there. It's not like I can tell them to turn it down. Let's see, from May, it just ended an exhibit, huh? On the second, Suzhou Museum inscribed stone tablets. The statue here, I think, is of Confucius. Confucius is sometimes parodied in the West and probably somewhat lampooned, I would think, in East Asia because his sayings are like these maxims, or at least that's how he's often quoted. Confucius say, followed by some pun. My favorite Confucius quote is, it's better to let people assume you're an idiot rather than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. You gotta be careful if you start running your mouth. You better know what you're talking about. So I think these are all probably famous Confucian maxims or codes of conduct. Like I was saying before, Confucianism is venerated by the state for its, I think anytime you have an authoritarian government, they're going to favor a philosophy or religion, whatever you want to call it, that supports paternalism. Especially, you know, you have the combination in China of an oligarchic authoritarian government, but it's combined with this peasant, farmer, people, family movement. And the state doesn't want to support the parents. The kids are supposed to support the parents under their model. Very weird mashup of socialism here and capitalism. So, like, you know, in the United States, they say we have capitalism, but we have Social Security as well. So, but it's made clear here to young children, you are going to support your parents when they get old. That is your job. And Don't even think of shirking that responsibility. Some gold fans. Fan covers. Preface. No, there's no English. What is it with the turtles and Confucianism? Everything's on the back of a turtle, huh? It's kind of neat how they got this stele up there. I guess it's all cement. Well, it looks like their exhibit's still going on. This is what they had on the banner out front. Some happy monks. The trouble with this stuff is when it's not art, there's not a lot of context for me to pick up on what's going on. So I'm at a real loss. There's no visual stuff. It's all language. I have no command of either Mandarin or Kanji characters. Let's see, who are these? Is that Engels? Or what's his name? Communist Manifesto. '56. Lenin. '57. Stalin and Lenin. Soviet Union kind of flips back and forth between friend and foe. When I was at the Communist Poster Propaganda Museum in Shanghai, you see that if you look close at the posters. Cold War politics. You know, you have that weird trilateral. The friend of my, the enemy of my enemy is my friend type thing, and things get a little dicey. You know, China and the United States were allies. Even the communists and the nationalists put aside their differences to fight the Japanese in World War II. Oh, lotuses are blooming nicely. They're really out here. When I was in the largest lotus pond in China, actually, in Hangzhou, there were only a few out. The lotus is actually a symbol of Buddhism, not Confucianism, because it grows out of a mucky pond. Very pure and white, and emulates metaphor for the light of the life of the Buddha, and we should seek to emulate that existence, even though we may be born into a world that's banal and impure. We should rise above and live lives that are pure and beautiful. You always see the Buddha seated on a lotus pedestal. Usually. Well, I guess that's about all there is to see. There's the bathroom, if you're wondering. Let's walk out the front and we'll take a look at that front gate. That looked pretty nice. And there's another statue of Confucius. Did I stop and look at this? Confucius say, man. Confucius say, only mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the noonday sun. I think I'll make some side trips from Suzhou if I have the time. If I hustle, I can probably do 5-6 gardens a day here easily. It's mostly what there is to see in Suzhou. A lot of former private residential gardens. I'd like to get to Wuxi and Tongli. I leave on the 24th of June. It's today the 13th. So I'll have 12 days here. I spent 12 days in Hangzhou already. And 25th, 26th, I'll stay in Zitang. Well, 24th, the night of the 24th and 25th, and then take a night bus back on the 26th to Shanghai. And I'm out of here on the 27th, back to the United States. I have a day or two at home. I think I'll leave on the 30th, June 30th, for Dublin. 2 weeks in Temple Bar. Meow. Meow. And I was gonna cat sit actually for my cousin. She's a professor at University of Edinburgh there, and she's going back for the summer to the States. But I'd already booked my time there during the date she'll be gone. She actually will leave a few days before I was supposed to get there, so I may just fly Ryanair or something to Edinburgh from Dublin to meet her before I go. And then I could have a few days to visit. She could take off and I could hang out while she's gone in Edinburgh. And then it's probably still early enough. I could book something for when she gets back. But it'll be pretty expensive. I was going to get out of Edinburgh on August 1st, check out that morning, because August 1st is the start of the Fringe Festival and everything gets super duper expensive. Prices essentially double. Speaking of which, here in Suzhou, if you don't want to stay in a hostel, which can't imagine why, the hotels here usually have 50% discounts if you ask. They're common anyway, it says in the Lonely Planet. Both hotels they mention, it says discounts of 50% or more are common. Scholars, the scholarly life of a monk. Procession and pageantry. I was trying to get a friend from Shanghai come stay this weekend. Today's Friday. She's worried about the World Cup. I'm like, are you kidding me? It starts at midnight and runs till like noon the following day if you want to watch it live. Why would you do that to yourself? She's like, well, it's only once every 4 years. I'm like, you just graduated from college. You sound like an English soccer hooligan. What are you, like a working class Mason from Liverpool. Got a root for Manchester United. I was like, you can't figure out how to watch it, record it, or watch it on the internet a few hours later. They have pretty fast Wi-Fi actually at the Suzhou Watertown Hostel where I am. I'm surprised. It wasn't that great when I was in the Hofong Hostel in Hangzhou. I was like, I'm offering you a free place to stay in Suzhou. He's like, I've been there already. I'm like, how long did you spend? She's like, just a few hours. I'm like, what? I don't know. Sometimes I forget how young people think now that I'm an adult, I guess. She reminds me of a friend I had who, I remember I saw him and he was doing the same thing. He wanted to take off from work so he could watch the World Cup, and his boss got real mad, wanted to fire him for even asking, and he got real mad at his boss and said he would quit if he didn't give him off. So the boss was like, you can't take off from work to watch television. And he's like, come on, man. It's the World Cup. It's not like it's just a soccer game. It's only every 4 years. That's what she said to me. She said, it's only every 4 years. I'm like, well, I was like, just watch the finals. What the hell? Oh no, I gotta watch them from the beginning. That's the whole point. I played sports. I never understood the purpose of why anyone would want to watch sports. I mean, that diligently anyway. It's one thing to like go to a live game for the experience and social aspects, but like to sit on your ass hours and hours watching sports, it's like almost the complete opposite of the purpose of sports. The athletic aspect of sports, to sit around watching and intellectualizing. It's like, it's not really supposed to be played. It's like the kids on the team who would sit the bench and be happy just to be on the team. Well, I'm happy just to be part of the team. That never made any sense to me. Happy to just be part of the team. Don't you want to play the game? So I guess I'll head down to the Blue Wave Pavilion. It's supposed to be one of the best. Woo, it's hot out. Blue Wave Pavilion. Or Blue Wave Garden, I think it is.